Доброе утро. Я не буду говорить по-русски, а стараюсь медленно по-английски, чтобы вы все поняли. Но позже, когда будут вопросы, если кто-то хочет по-русски говорить, я, может быть, я понимаю. So, this morning, I'm going to talk for maybe 15 to 20 minutes to explain who I am and to give some opinions that I hope will be useful and to give you enough context to ask me some questions and start a discussion. I always think, unless the speaker is amazing, it's much more interesting to hear them answer questions than to hear them give a speech. But at the same time, you need something to ask questions about. I have spent a lot of time in Russia. I've been to Ukraine a few times, and so I'm not going to talk about Ukraine or what you should do or anything like that, but just what I know from my own experiences in the United States and in Russia. And then for questions, whatever you want. I'm an American. I was actually born in Switzerland, and my father was a physicist who had studied Russian because where he grew up in England, all the great mathematicians were mostly from Russia, probably some from Ukraine, and he learned Russian in order to study from them. So when I grew up, the idea of learning Russian seemed quite normal, which is not normal for most Americans, but for me it was. So I learned Russian to some extent in high school and then completely forgot it until 1989, when I had already had a nice long career working as a conference organizer and as a newsletter writer for the tech sector. In my conference, we had speakers like Bill Gates, and much later, Sergey Brin, Stepan Pachikov from Paragraph, Steve Jobs, Mark Zuckerberg, Reid Hoffman, all these guys. So I watched this industry grow over the space of 25 years. And in the meantime, in 1989, I started visiting Eastern Europe and watching the emergence of the computer industry here, which gave me a very good perspective for understanding what was universal and what was specific to each culture. I like to say American salespeople are salespeople squared. Russian engineers are engineers squared. And both those two cultures need to understand each other better. So I watched from the beginning when Apple Computer and Microsoft were just starting, and it was a small little industry that nobody was watching. When I got onto an airplane and I saw someone working on their computer, I was excited because it was like meeting somebody from your town when everybody around you is from somewhere else. And of course, I watched this growth. My conference was originally called the Personal Computer Forum, and that was in 1982. And by 2007, when I sold the company, it was called the Platforms for Communication Forum, so PC in both cases, but everything had changed. The internet had arrived, the internet had gone global. Every time you got on an airplane, they told people, turn your computers off, because everybody was using them. Everything had changed. And in the beginning, software was tools. It was word processing, spreadsheets, later on, internet communications, messaging, email. But the software was very horizontal. that nothing specific to an industry. And that's been a big change. The first thing that happened in the software industry was it shifted from being on disks to everything was online. And then second was the rise of what I would call body parts. So if a software application or a company is a body, it has an independent existence. Now you have body parts, like Uber for shoe shines. What's the word for shoe shines? Что-то обуви. Чист обуви. Чистка обуви. Yeah, okay. That's not a company. That's a little application that ultimately should be part of some service. Maybe it's something that you can select with a bot, but it's changed dramatically. So what I'm seeing is this world where you have platforms, you have these little body parts, and then you have new markets. So now we've moved from Microsoft and Office products to Google and search and the internet, and messaging is becoming big. And the next thing is going to be these bots, which are really, they're basically a user interface that instead of being visual, is language. So you need some kind of machine learning that translates language into understanding an API for various kinds of services. It's going to be a huge market, understanding what people want, and also guiding them with an interface that's intelligent but not annoying. That's, I think, in some sense, one of the big markets coming. Another broad market is logistics and real-time dynamic scheduling, whether it's shipping products or driverless cars. A third one that's going to change logistics is 3D printing. So suddenly you have the software world changing the real world. Instead of moving things around by truck, you can print them locally. That changes a lot of things in the industrial world. Those are, to me, the three interesting areas that we're going to see developing. And then separately, there are lots of vertical applications like healthcare, banking, transportation logistics, all these specific industries. And I'm going to come back to those later. Or actually, I'll do it now. So if you're, I'll talk about Russia because I know Russia, you can interpret this for Ukraine the way you'd like to. If you're a Russian company, you understand Russian culture, you speak Russian, you know Russian problems, and you know technology. You're probably a mathematician or an engineer. So you can build really wonderful technology. I'm just going to see if I can make this not do what it, there. Is that better? Yeah. For the Americans in the audience, it's like Donald Trump sniffles. Okay, maybe not just the Americans. So anyway, it's much easier to enter the world market with technology than it is with culturally specific or industry specific software, because you need to understand your customer. And the, actually, this is a Ukrainian story, so I'll tell it. Long ago, I was here in Kiev. I gave a talk, and after the talk, a company came up to me and said, "Oh, Mrs. Dyson, we want your advice." And I said, "Okay, what about?" And they said, "Well, we have some accounting software, and we do accounting, and we want to know what to do next, or what new features to add." And I asked, "I see, well, do you already have customers?" They said, "Yes, we already have some customers." This was long ago, 1995 or something. And I said, "Okay, so what do your customers want?" And they said, "Well, what our customers want is really boring. We want your advice. And I'm glad you're laughing. Understanding what the customers want, understanding the user interfaces they're familiar with. If they're using Yandex, maybe your applications should have a similar interface so that people understand it. If they're using Google or they're using Salesforce.com, software is not intuitive, but it can be familiar. And making things that are familiar to the customer makes it so much easier. So understanding your market is really important. And I don't know whether there are as many incubators here. Is that a common thing, incubators, accelerators? So the best ones are industry specific, and they help a company understand, still trying to make this better. They help a company understand what the marketplace wants. And ideally, an incubator in health will have hospitals and health systems as partners in the incubator, or an incubator that sells to the automotive industry will connect you with automotive customers and the automobile industry, as well as giving you advice on marketing and sales and finance. Because understanding your industry is key. If someone were to ask me, how do I get into health software, I would say probably work for a health company for a few years so that you understand their problems and then you can come to solve them. And that's, for example, the company that brought me here is Proof Pilot. Matthew Amston is sitting here in the front smiling. His own customer. He was doing health research and understood the problems. And then that enabled him to design software that would, I'm just going to hold this thing, that would serve his customers effectively because he understood their problems. And what that means is that leaving the world of technology and going into the world of the customers requires a change in mentality and in approach that becomes much more industry specific. And for many engineers, that's a challenge to understand the customer. Second, I'd like to talk very briefly about the stages of a business. When you start a business, maybe it's you and a friend and some third person who's a business guy. It's half like a marriage and half like a company. People have to work with one another. There's no assigned roles. You just do what works. And it's very simple unless you get into arguments and then it falls completely apart. I've seen more companies fail from personal disagreements than because people were not a good programmer or something like that. As you grow, one person needs to become the CEO, and in the end, the CEO's job is not to do the work, but to run the company and to build the company and to think about the future and to grow. And the CEO's job is also to absorb uncertainty. In other words, to let the people do the work, to make them feel comfortable that if they do the work, things will turn out okay. And to kind of be like the parent so that the workers can simply get the job done, to figure out what does the customer need, who do we need to hire, to make all those decisions. As the company grows bigger, the CEO needs to share some of that uncertainty in order to help people develop. As the company grows even larger, you begin to form units, you need to think about how you incentivize people, how you set salaries, how you motivate people. You need to make sure that sales communicates with product development. And suddenly, you also need rules about things like vacation and hiring policies and who gets paid. It's bureaucracy is not good, but structures and rules are very useful as you get larger, because that means you don't need to decide every question each time. You have policies and procedures. Making that transition can be hard, and not everybody should or wants to become a CEO. Not everybody should want to be Sergey Brin or Mark Zuckerberg. And something I see in Silicon Valley that bothers me a lot is how many people say, I want to be CEO. I want to get rich. And instead of thinking, what interesting problem do I want to solve? What is my mission? It doesn't mean you need to be a saint and not make money, but you need some purpose beyond simply your job title. Or you don't have the persistence or the drive, and you're not likely to achieve much because you're too focused on your job and not enough on what it is you're building. And then finally, lots of Russian companies, and I don't know about Ukrainian companies, they always ask for my help in moving to the United States, because they read about Mark Zuckerberg and Reid Hoffman and Bill Gates and all these people. They think if you go to the US, it's easy to be successful. What they don't read about is all the failures and all the small companies and all the turnover. It's really, really hard. It's a very competitive market. For every company that's doing advertising technology in the healthcare space, there are 10 others competing with that one company. It's an extremely crowded market. And those people, they all know each other. They all speak perfect English. And it's actually a very hard market to enter from outside. That doesn't mean that there are not many successful foreign entries, but there are many more unsuccessful foreign entries. So my last point is going to be, it might be interesting to look at the problems in Ukraine. There's probably a lot of things that technology could help to be done more efficiently so that your lives could be easier. And so that when you talk to your grandmother about what you do, she might understand. I'm helping shops to organize trucks better so that when the tomatoes show up in the market, they're fresh. Or I'm helping you get access to government services more effectively. Or I'm changing it so that when you ask a question of a company, they respond promptly or they respond at all. I think it's really great to be outsourcers, but it's also really great to help build the technical infrastructure of your own country. And again, I don't know that much about Ukraine. I've seen some such improvements in Russia, including you can now pay your traffic fines online, which has dramatically reduced bribery. And the passport lines are faster because the passport system is now more electronic. You are the people in the world best equipped to solve Ukraine's problems. And so I hope you remember that as you decide what it is you want to do. Thank you.
Thank you, Esther, for your inspiring speech. And now we're inviting Maxim Lysak for fire chat.
Great. Do you want me just to hold the mic?
Maxim Lysak, Startup Depot.
Yeah, please.
We're going to go to release two.
Release two. Do you feel comfortable with this thing? Do you feel comfortable with this mic?
No.
Okay.
I think this will be better.
I just want to make sure that you feel comfortable for the next half an hour.
And now this will be more fun.
Sure. I hope so. So you promise to tell truth, and nothing but truth, right?
Yes. Maybe not the whole truth.
Okay.
But at least nothing but the truth.
Okay. Good. Fair enough. Okay, let's get started. So I appreciate that you didn't want to have a set of questions beforehand. So Esther just wrote me yesterday, let's improvise the whole thing. So thank you for that. So my first question to you would be concerning the mission. So you already told us that it's not a good thing to just want to be a CEO. It's a good thing to solve real world problems. So you are a very, very, very interesting person. You was a writer, a philanthropist, entrepreneur, mentor, investor. You had your training as a cosmonaut, right? Mm-hmm. So how do you make this decision in life? Do you have a certain vision of yourself in the future? Or you just catch opportunities that arise? Or it's like intuition, a passion?
Yeah. It's a really interesting question because I very rarely make decisions. I mean, I made a decision to come to Lviv, but I did not create a list, yes, no, you know, too far, very interesting, too many days, very interesting, whatever. Matthew Amston told me I should come. Luxoff told me I should come. Whatever. Usually, if you wait a little bit, the decision emerges. You know, in the end, you sort of know what you want to do. You just need to make sure that you listen to both sides. Mostly, I'm driven by curiosity. And the truth is, I came to Lviv because I've never been here before, and I thought it would be interesting, and I would learn something. As you've heard, I've been to Kiev. I was in Dnipro, I think, in 1995 when the first computer land opened. That was, anybody was there?
Yeah, yeah. One girl.
It was great. The police escorted us. We met the mayor. So most of what I do because I think I'll learn something. I worked as a fact checker for Forbes magazine for 3 years to learn about business. Then I went to Wall Street for 5 years to learn about business even more. And then I decided the most interesting area of business, so this was in 1982, was the computer business. Not IBM, but the Apple computer, Microsoft. And I took a job writing a newsletter about this early business called, well, it was called Rosen Electronics Letter. And I joined the man who was writing it, who then became the chairman of Lotus and of Compaq Computers, some very ancient companies. But because he was so involved, it created a conflict of interest. So I bought the business from him for a very small amount of money. And then for 25 years, I wrote about what was happening in the computer industry. And it was the best job in the world. You could call up Bill Gates, and he would answer your questions. You could talk to Steve Jobs. You could go to almost anybody in the business, and they would happily tell you at least their version of what they were doing and why. So I did that for 25 years. And in 1989, there was a friend of mine going on a trip to visit the Russian computer industry. So I said, can I come and be your translator? Which was sort of a joke, because my Russian was not very good then. And we spent 3 weeks in Moscow visiting, at the time, Alexei Pajitnov, who created Tetris, and Stepan Pachikov, who had a company called Paragraph. And I also met Arkady Volosh, but at that time he was completely not famous. It was amazing. There was no understanding of business. This was the time when the government had said you can have something called co-ops. They didn't like the word company. It sounded sort of too capitalist and evil. But you could have a co-op. And all these little software co-ops were starting. Meanwhile, in Hungary and Poland, the same sort of thing was happening. Microsoft and Hewlett-Packard and Oracle were coming along and offering training. Anyway, you asked, how do I make decisions?
Yeah.
So I just do what I think is, I do what I think is going to be useful and interesting and important to learn. So that's how I got involved with healthcare. My father was involved in the space industry. So I didn't think it was very interesting because my dad was doing it. And then in 1990-95, I realized, how come we aren't back on the moon again? What's going on? So I got interested in space, invested in a company called Space Adventures, and they said, for $40 million, you can go to the space station. Or for $3 million, you can train. So I said, okay, I'll take the cheap version. And I spent 6 months in Star City outside Moscow training as a backup to Charles Simonyi, which was amazing. So I first went to Russia in 1989, and I thought I'd like to learn about Soviet Russia. What was it really like? And in Star City, I got that experience.
Okay.
Because it was a government place. I wanted to learn about genetics. And Sergey Brin told me his wife had a genetics startup called 23andMe. So I joined the board of 23andMe to learn more about genetics and that whole area. So that's how I make decisions. Is it going to be interesting? Is it going to be useful? And you know, maybe it will help make some money so I can do what I like, but.
Okay, thank you. You're a very modest person, because you've mentioned about your career as a journalist, but you haven't told anything to the guys for your investor career, right? Your fund adventure invested companies like Facebook, LinkedIn, Square, Evernote, Flickr,
yeah.
I know, Yandex, Luxoft, okay. EPAM. So these are the companies you've invested in.
Yeah.
So my question to you would be, do you mention a certain pattern in entrepreneurs so you can say, oh, these guys can be successful and this has no chance to be successful?
So you gave a list of where I've been lucky.
Sure.
Now, let me see if I can remember the list of where I was unlucky. There was Power Systems, there was Yik Yak, there was, you know, the ones that fail you usually don't even remember, but I've made about probably 150 or 200 investments. And I would say maybe the ones you mentioned and maybe 10 more have been really successful. And the others, not so much. Some of them are still, you know, it's not clear, are they dead or alive? Every once in a while I get an email saying, oh, we shut this company down. Unfortunately, we're not sending you any money back. And so, yes, I try to make smart investments. Sometimes when I sit on a board, I get much more involved. But most people who make money investing, you need a combination of some intelligence, some access to deals, and a lot of luck. So, you know, I've been in the industry, I know a lot of people, I get access to good deals, but it really, so I worked on my own company for 25 years, worked very hard, and it was wonderful. It gave me a huge return in terms of knowledge, in terms of, again, knowing everybody in the industry and so forth. I did not want it to grow. Its real purpose was my education. And I sold it finally for about $2 million. You know, that was okay.
Let me rephrase my question. Yeah. So when a founder coming to you, what do you want to see in him?
Okay. Or her.
Or her.
So I want to see what I said before, some sense of mission. So if someone says, I want to be CEO and this company is going to give you $2 billion, yeah, I'm not interested because I'm not interested that they want to be CEO, and I don't believe that it will give me $2 billion. You know, maybe it will, maybe it won't. If they say, here's a really interesting problem, and I have a solution, and I understand this solution probably isn't exactly the right solution, so in 3 years it will be different, but I really understand the problem, and I understand the environment, and that, to me, is very interesting. Then I want to know, are they good with people? Do they have the right industry contacts? And so I'll give the story of the most interesting company I've invested in recently, and why I decided to invest in it. It's not highly techy. It's more a business model. And I think much innovation now is business models. It's called Civil Comments. It was started by a woman who used to work for TED, the big conference company. And the problem it's dealing with is the problem of moderating comments. So if you have an online news service or a blog or you're a big publisher, you're going to get lots of really stupid comments. And some of them will just be stupid. Some of them will be purposely untrue. Some of them will be really nasty, and some of them will be okay but kind of useless, like, I agree. So the business model is, before you make a comment, you, the customer, you, the reader, you have to rate 3 other comments. It's kind of like paying. So you pay in labor, and then you yourself are allowed to comment. So that reduces the really stupid comments, like I agree, and it provides a rating service for the rest of the comments. Now, anybody could copy that. But to do it well, and then to build an infrastructure, to build the software that makes it work on lots of different publishers' platforms, and then you can create all kinds of sliders. Do you want only really smart comments, only really nice comments? Do you want kind of a lot of vigorous argument? So it can be adjusted. And now they're selling it to publishers, which is really useful because a lot of news sites have closed down their comments. Now they can open them up again and have the customers do the rating service. What's even more interesting is big brands, they want to have an online presence. They want their customers to comment. And they don't want to be censors. So for them, it's really politically important to have a system that allows them to let their users moderate the comments, yet at the same time have a civil platform. So I invested in that because I love what they're doing. I think they have a mission. I think they're going to improve the service. It has a real business model. And there's a bunch of commenting platforms, but none of them really has the cleverness of this particular approach. So that's an example. Now, I've invested in everything from online dispute resolution to Evernote to, to me, I like things that are unique and really interesting, where there's a very good idea and the idea can be copied, but the implementation can be done better and better. And that's what I'm looking for.
Okay, thanks.
I hope that's useful.
Mm-hmm. In the audience, we have very different people. We have software developers, we have designers, product managers, CEOs of the startups, and CEOs of the largest Ukrainian tech companies. But the thing that unites all of us is the desire to know what is going to happen next in 2 years, in 3 years, in 4 years. Actually, the motto of our conference is, we change the future, we are the future. So I want to try to foresee. I know that foreseeing is very unthankful thing, but let's try to foresee the future. You already mentioned that the next big things you anticipate is 3D printing, logistics, and bots. But can you go a little bit deeper in that and say, how do you see technology changes our world in the next 3-5 years? Because in order to be ready for that, we have to start now.
Yes. Well, I mean, to be honest, the most interesting thing technology has done is change the world from a world where one part of the world kind of created the news, told the stories. There was, whether it was big government or big business, there were people who spoke and then everybody else listened and maybe commented, to a world where everybody can speak and they can write their own stories. Some of these stories are true, some are false. And it's created a world that's very confusing. In the US, we have Donald Trump, who creates his own stories. And a lot of people are unhappy. To many people, the world seems incoherent. And finding something that makes the world seem more coherent, I think, is the big challenge the world faces. I'm not sure that technology is the answer. Something like civil comments, actually, I hope will help. Mm-hmm. But you know, it's a small little thing. And there, honestly, we need better leadership, not better technology. We need politicians who are honest and respected and not out for themselves. I talked to somebody I know who's close to the Russian government, and I was not stupid enough to ask him for all kinds of inside stories because that wouldn't work. Instead, I asked him, think of the top 50 people in the Russian government. Do you know anybody who is honest and sincerely cares about the welfare of the Russian people?
And the answer was?
No. That was pretty horrifying. And that does not depend on the Russian government. It depends on the Russian people to start choosing people whom they trust, people who are worthy of that trust. When I was watching the beginning of the Russian computer industry, private enterprise was mostly two kinds of people. It was drivers and security people and restaurants. These were all things that had sort of existed in the black market already. And then suddenly, with the rise of the computer industry, there were these little programming companies. And the drivers and the security people in the restaurants were, that had been a black market. And so those business people were used to paying bribes and doing things like that. So when the Russian computer companies started, they just assumed that if you wanted a business partner, it had to be someone who was kind of sleazy and a dishonest salesperson. And so they looked for the wrong kind of people, because there are honest business people. But the common perception of business was that it was dirty. Mm-hmm. And that really had a bad influence on the industry for quite a while. The thing that was positive was when you started, instead of writing software for companies and paying bribes, you can't bribe a consumer to come to your website. So a company like Yandex had to be honest, and they had to offer a good service because the customers wouldn't come otherwise. And in general, consumer businesses are cleaner because you have to provide something your customers want. And if anybody asks, the role of the government is not to invest in companies. It's to be an honest customer. That's the very best thing a government can do.
Sure.
For a startup industry.
I can reassure you that people who are sitting in this audience, these are the people with a different set of values that Ukrainians, Russian people had in the 90s. So these are the people who want to build really competitive global products.
Right.
And
build competitive local products too, because that will help your families. It will help your own lives.
So, what would you recommend them to do? Where, what are the next things that are worth start to work right now?
Well, honestly, on the one hand, there's what I said. There's better logistics, real-time scheduling, real-time demand management, machine learning, chatbots that understand, you know, domain-specific chatbots. People, you know, however intelligent people are, if you kept them in one room for 18 years, they would emerge pretty useless. The reason people are so smart is they spend their first 18 years running around, doing things, finding out. And so in the same way, you need to build chatbots that have a lot of domain-specific knowledge, that understand specific industry problems, whether it's mining, construction, healthcare, retail, you know, lots and lots of industry-specific problems that can be handled much more effectively. Then, you know, 3D printing is an interesting market because what it's going to make happen is that the materials used in some sense become more important than the 3D printing, you know, the software. The software can be copied easily. The materials matter much more. So material science and finding and mixing and basically making materials that do the right things when you do 3D printing is going to become a much bigger industry. And, you know, I really don't know. I know Ukraine has mines for various kinds of things. I'm not sure. I don't know much about the details. But understanding material science and the properties of materials becomes much more important, which is not a software problem, but software that understands what the materials do becomes important. And as I said, that changes logistics, it changes how many kinds of businesses are organized. You no longer need to manage inventories as effectively. There's going to be more real-time delivery of everything, so that changes the economics of retailing and of distribution of goods as well. Those are some of the big ones.
Yeah, thank you. The second question I want to ask you is about tech industry in Ukraine. So if you look at tech industry in Ukraine, 95% of it is IT outsourcing, which is a great industry. It gives jobs to, I think, 100,000 people. And it creates more jobs around this industry. It's growing. So my question to you would be, do you think it can be a winning strategy for Ukraine to be a number one destination for IT outsourcing in the world, or not?
To be candid, no. But it can be a much bigger and more effective business than it is now, but the sheer numbers of Ukrainians, you need to be number one in quality rather than in quantity, and that's a realistic goal.
How do we improve this quality?
I think partly it's understanding that you need to understand the customer's specific needs, that vertical market capacity. I was 3 days ago, I was at a healthcare conference in California, and I met a guy who's got a development team in Serbia. Mm-hmm. And they're good programmers, but what really makes them different is they understand the US healthcare industry, which is very hard to understand. Most American programmers don't understand it either. You have a lot of American healthcare startups. Three guys come out of college, they say, I'm going to re-engineer the hospital admission process. And they really don't have a clue how it works. So, yeah, they have this very nice software, but it doesn't connect to the actual hospital's admissions process. So understanding your customer, whatever it is, whether it's a bank in England or a healthcare company in the US or a Swedish telco or, but getting from providing just the platform to understanding the customer's problems, being able to propose solutions, help them understand how to run their business is key.
Okay, thanks. And I have a last question for you, and then we can turn to the questions from the audience. Okay. So my last question for you would be, let's imagine that you are on the other side of the audience, and you're in your late 20s or mid-20s, and what would be the message you would like to hear from you where you're now?
That life is going to be perfect. But but the message really is the most important thing is to align your goals with your capacity. In other words, don't try and do what your mother thinks you should do, what your girlfriend or boyfriend thinks you should do, what your teacher thinks you should do. Focus on what you think you should do. It may change over time. For me, it's changed many times. But there's no way you're going to be happy trying to please somebody else. I mean, yes, you should please your customers, but in terms of what your mission is, it should be your own. And it should match, well, it should slightly exceed your capacity.
The goals, you mean?
Yeah. I have a joke, but it's not really a joke. It's never take a job for which you are already qualified. Take a job that's going to teach you something. And from the point of view of a company, that's not a nice message because they just want to look for people who are already qualified. Just hire them, make them do the work. But a good company trains people and develops them and helps the people in the company grow, and then both sides benefit. So it's like a mutual investment. And if you're looking for a job, find a company that will invest in you. If you're building a company, invest in your own people. And create something that creates more value than you put in. Because a good investment expands the value. And that should be your goal, to expand your own value by expanding the value of whatever you interact with.
That was nice. I think we guys have time for two questions.
Especially if I answer them quickly.
Yeah, sure. Do we have questions from the audience? Can you raise your hand if you do? Yeah. There was a question. Okay.
Hi. Thank
please,
you.
Please tell your name.
My name is Eugene. Thank you for your speech. It was really cool and inspiring. I have one question. What do you think about the future of such area like biogenetics and updating people, implants, and so on? Do you think it will be huge in few years or 10 years? I don't know.
So, synthetic biology, basically. I think it's, I should have mentioned it, I think it's going to be huge, and it kind of combines my interests in space and my interests in genetics. If we want to go to Mars, we're going to need synthetic biology probably to make human beings more radiation resistant, and definitely to create some kind of plants that will help Mars develop an atmosphere. And also, how many of you have seen the movie The Martian? Yeah, okay. Well, then you know the answer. Gardening is the answer. To a lot of problems, to sustainability on Earth, as well as sustainability on Mars. In terms of engineering humans, I think it's going to happen. It's a very complicated topic. There are a lot of ethical questions. You know, one question is, what is a disability? Is someone who's autistic disabled? Or are they just different with other kinds of abilities? Would you want to eliminate autism? Do you want to make people more intelligent than they are naturally? Do you want to create something that maybe is not even human? You know, if it's better than beings, you know, we've just been talking about the fallibilities of human beings, that would be great, but who decides whether they're better? So, but yes, it's going to happen one way or another, and please think carefully about what you do, because it might have implications.
Yeah, we have a question over there.
Alexei, my question is about, like, America was a leader in everything IT. That's bigger market, internet penetration, internet payments, all the things. And developing countries are markets for the second-hand ideas often. Like the same which were there like 10 years ago is now working here, so to say. Do you think that people who are trying in Ukraine to build something really innovative, something new to the world, are basically fooling themselves in the same way like these young CEOs are trying just to be CEO while they don't understand what it takes?
So first of all, I would say that in messaging, SMS in particular, but you know, also WhatsApp, Tencent, things like that, the United States was not in fact the leader. People were using SMS over here long before they did in the US. To the second question, I think the world has now become flatter as far as concerns fundamental technology. You know, there's no reason you can't do deep learning in Ukraine as well as you can in the US. To some extent, you guys have an advantage because Americans don't understand markets outside the US. They kind of think the center of the world is the US. There's a phrase they use in the United States that you don't really hear elsewhere. It's rest of world. You know, it's like there's us and then there's everything else. Smaller countries understand that you need to export. You need to be international from the start if you want to be successful. So, yes, you can do it here, but that's about underlying technology. Vertical markets, much tougher.
But do you think it's possible to understand customers, global customers, being here?
No, and it's not possible to understand them just being in the US either. I mean, fundamentally, you need to be international. Countries outside the US tend to be better at being international because they're forced to from an early age. Whereas you can build a fine business in the US and never go outside the US. You cannot build a large-scale business in Ukraine the same way without going outside Ukraine. So you get forced to do that earlier. That doesn't mean it's easy or that everybody will do it, but it's definitely possible.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Esther, for your very thoughtful and inspirational answers. And now we have a special guest. Special guest who wants to meet you and all of our audience. Welcome, Mayor of Lviv, do we have? Andriy Sadovy. Andriy Sadovy.
He's coming from here.
Boom, boom, boom. Do we have Andriy Sadovy?
On the video.
Andriy is coming, okay? Andriy is coming.
What is his name? Andriy. Okay. So stay here. Yeah. And thank you.
Hi.
Good morning.
I have a small gift.
Oh.
It's a year.
You should. Do you want to talk to me?
450 лет тому назад Иван Федоров в Львове сделал первый букварь. Это букварь, который изменил эту жизнь.
Спасибо.
Добрий ранок, красиві дівчата і поважні чоловіки. Good morning, everybody. Дякую. Я домовився з Естер на понеділок на окрему розмову, але зараз мав честь подарувати їй автентичну копію букваря, яку Іван Федоров зробив у Львові більше 400 років тому назад. Тому цей буквар змінив велику частину світу, так само, як ви сьогодні міняєте цей світ. Дякую, Естер, вам. Дякую.
Дякую.
Шановні друзі, я коротко хотів би декілька слів. Коли я почав працювати мером, то в нас з командою дуже багато було мрій. І, власне, ці мрії ми виклали у візію, місію, стратегію. І дуже велику кількість тих мрій ми зреалізували. І цей стадіон – це також була наша мрія. Там і новий аеропорт – це була наша мрія. І IT-сектор, бізнес-конференції – це все були наші мрії. Але у владі не так легко реалізовувати мрії. Власне, вам, людям, які працюють в IT, це, мені здається, набагато простіше зробити. І я би не був мудрим керівником, якщо би не скористався можливістю, щоб зробити для вас певну пропозицію. Є така думка, що, власне, Україна є центр аутсорсингу, і ми не маємо замовників тут, в Україні, які би могли, власне, споживати цю продукцію, яку ми продукуємо, виробляємо. В чому заключається ідея? Ми у Львові маємо цілий ряд різних проєктів, коли ми фінансуємо різні райони міста Львова і підтримуємо різні креативні ідеї. Наприклад, спільно з IT-кластером ми визначаємо один мікрорайон міста Львова і оголошуємо конкурс на ідеї і на речі, які можуть бути корисні для цього мікрорайону. І, власне, міська влада буде замовником тих речей і буде фінансувати ці речі, які ви можете зробити. Що ви мали позитивні приклади, які потім можна буде демонструвати для інших міст, для інших країн світу. І я би хотів, щоб ми дуже швидко почали це робити, тому що ми починаємо бюджетний процес і будемо закладати кошти в бюджеті на наступний рік, що, власне, коли будемо проводити наступний IT-форум тут у Львові, щоб ми вже могли запрезентувати ці ідеї. Тобто беремо один мікрорайон, і дивимося, що там можна зробити кращим для життя людей. Місто це замовить, ви це виготовите, ми вас це купимо, ви заробите гроші, місто отримує задоволених львів'ян, які будуть щасливі від хорошого сервісу. Приймається? Дякую. Я думаю, що ми за IT-сектором цю ідею чітко сформулюємо, так? Щоб вона була зрозуміла і всі учасники IT-форуму, і всі бажаючі могли взяти в цьому участь. І на завершення одна маленька думка. Мені дуже цікаво було почути виступ Естер і ці запитання, які були. Насправді ми всі в пошуку. Ніхто не знає, яким буде цей світ через 5, 10, 20 років. Життя дуже швидко міняється. Але лишаємося ми з вами, людина. Я нещодавно прочитав одну дуже просту думку, яку озвучив патріарх Сербії Павло. Хотів просто її вам переповісти своїми словами. Ми з вами не вибираємо країну, в якій ми народжуємося. Ми не вибираємо час нашого народження. Ми не вибираємо народ, серед якого ми народжуємося. Ми вибираємо тільки одне – бути людьми або бути нелюдами. Я маю велике прохання і велике побажання, щоб все добре, що ви робите, ви робили, щоб воно було корисне для всіх людей доброї волі. Я вам бажаю добра, щоб ви були багаті, щасливі і здорові. Слава ІТ, слава Україні! Дякую!